Founded in 2007, Czech Games Edition released their first titles in Galaxy Trucker by Vlaada Chvatil and League of Six by Vladimir Suchi. Since then, CGE has published over 40 games and expansions, including Codenames, Alchemists, Dungeon Lords, Zulkin, Last Will, Space Alert, Dungeon Pets, Tash Kalar, and many others. Tonight we have Tony from Czech Games Edition here on a very special episode of the Board Boys podcast to tell me how badly I've just pronounced the names of their two biggest designers.
Tonight on the Board Boys, Czech Games Edition.
Hey everyone, welcome to another special edition of the Board Boys, aka the Quarantine Boys. With us tonight is a special guest, but first, let's take it around the table and introduce ourselves. I am, as always, Culture Boy Ben, with all the culture.
This is just Board Boy Rob tonight, because I don't have any fancy intros.
Plus one puppy, Board Boy Rob.
Yeah, plus one puppy.
This is crushed the other Board Boys at Through the Ages a couple days ago, Cam. And that's like the only win I'll ever get in the game, except for I beat Rob today too, also once out of like 10 times. But Rob is actually the winner if we're counting like legacy, right? We are joined tonight by Tony from Czech Games Edition. How you doing, Tony?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Excellent. You know, Ben, we played that. We played it like a pre-game before that didn't finish until after our normal game, and Ben actually beat Campbell and I in his very first game, like by a lot.
Yes,
by a lot.
So I guess it's AI assist by me or the other way around. But yeah,
but they
only guys and I timed out.
Yeah, they only finished like the last two or three turns for you though, man. You had a
solid some good stuff
setup
going.
Yeah, for sure. So this is a special episode. We're going to be talking about a lot of stuff Czech Games Edition related. I'd like to just start off by saying that, like, I'm just the – if you've ever listened to the podcast before, I'm probably the biggest, like, proponent of CGE there is. Like, they are my company. I love them so much. I have been, like, a CGE fanboy ever since I got, like, back into board games because, like, I was a huge theme guy to begin with and, like, Dungeon Lords and Last Will and Dungeon Pets and just like reading those rule books and like how they integrate with the theme and mechanisms. And God, I just love it all so much. And I think I might, every BGG con, I tend to like hit the virtual flea market. And I think I have every title now from CGE. I don't think I'm missing any. I even have like League of Six. Some of them are unplayed still, but I do think I have them all. And they're definitely like, if they release something new, it's like an insta buy for me. So anyway, just let everybody know where I'm standing at.
Well,
you collect Codenames editions like I collect Oreos.
Well, I don't have all the Codenames editions, but those are Codenames actually, besides Codenames pictures and the regular one and duet, you guys work with, the OP?
Yeah. Yeah. So we actually work with a number of different companies to license out the different brands at this time. The OP is the big one that does the Disney, Marvel, Simpsons now, Harry Potter.
Yeah. Harry Potter.
But the Underdark or the, not Underdark, the
After Dark
edition is done by actually a separate company. So.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Naughty Games Limited.
Yeah, so I mean Czech Games has been around for quite a while now, but like it seems like they really busted into the scene like with Codenames, as far as like the year after Codenames came out, you just started seeing the name a lot more places, like started sponsoring like Gen Con and sponsoring all these cons and having a bigger presence, and it's just been wonderful to watch like the company seem to evolve and I'm guessing grow.
Yeah, so like Codenames did something that, I mean, every every gaming company really wants to have happen is something where it breaks you into the opportunity to do more. And kind of what Conan's allowed us to do is, if you notice, if you go to conventions and stuff, we typically have our own rooms. So we have these separate rooms that you go to. We're not usually in the exhibit hall and stuff like that. It gave us the ability to take these separate spaces and make it just like a comfortable gaming area for Czech Games fans. And that's really been kind of the big thing that we've always was driven with, is trying to make space for gamers that, and to play games made by gamers. And yeah, it's really the big thing.
Yeah, your Gen Con room is amazing. I mean, it's kind of a reprieve from like the giant hall, and you do something really unique there, like by pretty much bringing your current library to play, right? I mean, like everything that is currently on sale or like in your current catalog of games, you've got out, you've got people demoing, like Cam and I, we demo for you guys the last 3 or 4 years, and Cam's done the last couple of years, and we have a blast.
Yeah, the last two. Yeah. I taught a Dungeon Lords like probably 100 times in a row this last year, and a lot of people wanted to play it, and they only had like 2 copies of it out, I think.
Mm-hmm. And that's what we do. We have, of course, focus on the new games, but because a lot of new players coming in or existing fans want to play what the new thing is. But we always try to have the entire catalog playing at Gen Con so that everyone can come in and play Zolkin and Pulsar, Dungeons, Lords, and Pets, like, and even like Last Will, Prodigals Club, and getting some of the expansions in there too, like Sacked and stuff like that.
You guys even had a copy of a Shipyard out there the last couple of years.
That's
going back there.
That is going back there. I think the ones that you won't see is kind of you don't see League of Six out there very much anymore. Shipyard's one that we don't typically play around that much. Or
the other ones I've got on my
Travel Blog.
I don't have Travel Blog. That might be the one.
I think that's so there's a couple of the older ones that
I do Rob. I do have Goblins Inc. and 20th Century are kind of the other two older ones I've got besides League of Six.
A lot of those were the initial games that weren't actually published by Czech Games Edition, but were designed by our owners that we then
kind of brought into the catalog,
yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I really noticed a big difference in you guys when, like, Rio Grande, I think, used to print your games in the U.S., and then, I don't know, was it maybe 4 or 5 years ago, you kind of started doing your own distribution here?
Yeah, we had a great partnership with them, but it was one of those things where it was kind of time for us to kind of do our own thing and take it in-house, especially when we started bringing in digital and everything else. It kind of made it like we really need to set things apart and make it our own entity.
Sure. So, I mean, if you've listened to the Board Boys podcast before, we've had if you haven't listened to all of our back catalog episodes, we've had multiple CGE games on here. We did Alchemists in Season 1, Episode 7, if you want to check that out. And that was actually, I was not on the podcast yet. Ben was not on the podcast yet. This was back when it was Campbell, Josh, Frank, plus guest. And Alchemists was my first guest spot on this podcast because, I mean, it's one of my favorite games. And one of Cam's favorite games as well.
Yeah, Alchemist is not just my favorite Czech Games Edition game. It's probably in my top 5 perennial favorite games, maybe top 3. It's really, really brilliant.
Yeah, and then you guys did Codenames Season 2, Episode 9. Then Zolkin was the second episode that all 4 of us that are the current hosts, that's the second episode we did. I remember doing that at Ben's house.
Yeah,
that's season 3, episode 10. Some Zolkin, and Ben actually bought Zolkin after we played that, right?
I did. Yep.
Yeah. Have you played it since you bought it?
Nope. I mean, I mostly play with you guys, and I mean, we can see Rob's like half of or a third of Rob's games in the background here. So we don't get called on like my board game collection very often. But
well, right. You should get a game going on BGA with me and Rob. Maybe that's Tony. Maybe Tony will play with us.
Let's do it.
Yeah, we're
actually, honestly, I'm up for going.
I'm saying, Tony, for just a little dive into the Board Boys dynamic here. I mean, these two guys here are pretty hardcore about this. Josh is as well. I would say not to this extent. I'm here for like the casual gamer's perspective. I'm always down to try anything new, so that's probably what floats me along. But I'll play a game on the Board Boys and be like, well, that was great, and then I'll see someone selling it like at a good deal, and I'll buy it, and then I can't convince any of my other friends to play it, but I'll have it here.
Yeah, I mean, I would say my spiel for the Board Boys is you've got me who basically plays everything. Cam's the more Euro-focused guy. Josh is the more dudes on the map Ameritrash-focused guy. And Ben is our liaison to the world.
You know, I think about it a little differently because I don't know. I'm pretty omni for a cube pusher. But to me, it's more like Josh really loves gaming news. I really love playing board games. And then Rob likes both. So that's maybe more like what the dynamic is.
Did you say gaming nude?
Gaming news. But Josh does like gaming nude. Josh does game nude. Every time we play like in that attic of his, well, he's moving now. He's like, oh, it's too hot up here. And he takes his shirt and pants off, makes us stick around. He's in his underwear playing board games. He thinks it's okay because it's his house.
Please see episode 2, season 1.
We talked about it 2 episodes ago in the Kalis episode, I believe.
Go ahead, Tony.
No, but I'll be honest. Like, Tyler would probably be a better threat when you bring in the heavy games, because he's definitely the crunchier player on the Czech team from the U.S. Justin and I, we have this running bet of who loses worst and who wins best, like not best. And so you're just sitting there. It's like we have this running thing where the first time we play a game with each other, it's a big deal because whoever loses that game is like forever the worst at that game.
That's excellent.
But then any other time, it's kind of like, everyone else is running ahead of the pack, and Justin and Tony are way in.
Yeah, I want to say the first year that I helped demo for you guys, it was Justin that I met. And then they brought Tyler on, and now they brought you on. So, like, you guys have all been great. Like, whenever I see you guys at cons, super friendly. Like, and you guys run a good ship over here, I think, representing CG in the U.S. for sure.
We try.
As far as the Czech Games library goes, there's a huge dichotomy. It seems to be like, I don't know, when I think of Czech Games, I think of like exclusively like really crunchy, or on the flip side, it's like very accessible, just brilliant party games. I don't know if there's any games I'd put like in the middle. I would say they're all like stuff I would like would consider to be like well thought out, crunchy Euros, and then like just ingenious party games.
So more in the middle, we're kind of stepping into more, a little bit more medium weight with like Sanctum, but you're still talking a heavier game than most players are just going to jump into initially.
Yeah, I mean, I think Sanctum and like Adrenaline kind of fall in that mm-hmm. middle spot, and like I think Pulsar 2849, I'd say, is like a middleweight type Euro.
Yeah, true.
I mean, there's a lot of choices in there, but and the party games, they're not your average party game. I mean, they are a gamer party game, right, for the most part. I mean, besides maybe Codenames is really mainstream now, and like that was a hit with pretty much anyone I ever like introduced it to. But like Trap Words is pretty gamey, and definitely like Letter Jam. And Pictomania is like the gamiest drawing game ever.
Oh, yeah, but they're still all super accessible.
Oh, they are.
Mm-hmm.
We've
been having a lot of fun with Letter Jam lately.
And the app right?
Yeah, so it's a companion app. It just helps you do setup. It makes the words for all the different players. So
cool.
It kind of allows you to skip the explanation of how the game is set up and just jump into, here are your cards, let's jump right into the game. Because that's the one thing with Large Jam that we've had people be like, what's going on? Is just when you're trying to explain, no, this whole first part, you're making a word, but it's completely just the setup of the game. It's you're not playing yet, and just getting people to understand that that's been so. The companion app jumps you right past that segment. So,
have you ever been in a game of letter jam where people end up making a word that wasn't the word that was picked for them? Because I know that's like in the rules. That's never occurred in a game I've been in, but like I think that the possibility for that's kind of funny.
Especially when you so. Once you start playing letter jam a little bit more frequently and get and actually try to start getting the higher level clues and scores, that's when you see that happening, because then you're actually adding you're going to be adding on letters to your word regardless of what it is. So to get the higher scores, you'll be making different words. Typically the first few times you play though, or when you're playing in a more casual setting, it doesn't happen that often, but
gotcha.
It's always fun when it does.
And then just to go back, the last episode we did, it would be the week before this one dropped. So if you're listening to this, go back one episode and listen to Through the Ages. That one will have dropped the week previous to this episode. And we played that via the Through the Ages app. Some of us played on Steam and some of us played on iOS. So it's cross-platform, and you can go back and listen to that episode, but I'm just going to say, in my opinion, it's the best board game app I've ever played. It's the one I play by far the most, for multiple different reasons. I think the main thing is, like, I'm playing a game of Sagrada right now with Josh on the app. And in Sagrada, you pick a dice, and that's kind of your turn. And you might do with another thing. And in a worker placement game, like, sometimes I play Lords of Waterdeep, and you move a guy on a spot and you take the stuff and you're done. It's like your turns are like really quick, and so it's a lot of effort to like get into an app just to put a guy on the board and then you're done with your turn. Through the Ages turns are like finky. You get to do multiple things together like in one little crunchy time and then push them out, and like you feel like getting on the app was like worth your time, I think.
Yeah.
I think it's the biggest thing, and I think playing that game asynchronously might be the best way to play that game, period.
We said this before we started recording too, but I think it's an awesome app for someone who doesn't, pull up every game app like Rob might. I think it's implemented really well. There's a lot of spots when you're playing on the app itself where I was kind of thinking, man, that was pretty easy and might have not been so easy playing on the table. The one thing that jumps to mind is the undo function. I think Josh is probably the worst at it, but we'll be deep into a game and he'll do a bunch of complicated stuff and then realize that wasn't what he wanted to do and ask to undo it, which at best takes up a lot of time. So it's cool to try something with your actions, and if it didn't get you where you wanted to be, just click undo and scoot back a little ways.
Yeah, and like you and Josh learned the game from the app. So you learned like one of the heaviest, weightiest games out there, like from a tutorial and an app. So, and you had like very, very few questions for us. So pretty fantastic.
The tutorial on that is phenomenal too. It's really, really, really good.
Yeah.
You learn from Vlaada.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ancient Vlaada, but yeah.
Yeah, and he likes to throw in the humor in there just like they do in the rule books. And there's one, I don't want to spoil it for anybody, but there's a certain point in the tutorial where you just like stop for a second, you're like, wait a minute. And then you go for it and you just laugh. It's just, there's one point in the tutorial that is more about like how mainstream apps really do work these days and how a board game app works not that way.
Rob's just really setting this joke up. Now it won't even catch people off guard.
I know, right? So, I mean, let's talk about, I guess, Tony, what would you say, like, what's your favorite game that Czech Games Edition puts out? What's your favorite heavy game? And then what's your favorite, like, small box party game?
Okay. So my favorite heavy game from Czech Games Edition, and this is being a little bit, like, cheaty, but it is Sanctum. So coming in with Sanctum, it's been a lot of fun for me because I came into gaming with Dungeons and Dragons.
Oh, sure.
So I came in with Dungeons and Dragons miniatures, wargaming with like Games Workshop, Blood Bowl type stuff. So coming into Czech Games was kind of interesting because it's going from a rather randomized gaming background to one that is not random at all. And so the thing is that Sanctum had a little bit of that feel of, I have the perception that I'm rolling dice and killing monsters, even though the game itself really isn't that at all. And so you have the theme and the going through and jumping through the hoops to kill the demons, and you are gaining the loot and upgrading your character, as well as working through the skill tree to gain your skills and everything. And it had this very familiar theme to me playing JRPGs, from coming from Dungeons and Dragons, from all of that, it made it an easy segue for me.
Well, it gives you that dopamine loop too, that like an RPG does, of like, mm-hmm. I did this, now I can upgrade and I can go do it better to get more stuff so I can upgrade. Now I'm right there with you. It really satisfies, because I'm a video gamer and a tabletop gamer also. And the really fun thing about that game is like gearing out your guy, and it gives you that like really satisfying feeling of becoming more powerful constantly while you're playing a Euro game. Man, what a concept. It's cool.
Yeah, between that and Adrenaline, those are the two games you can trick your video game friends into playing and be like, aha, you just played a Euro game.
Yeah, by the way, let's explain these mechanics in a fashion that is not,
yeah,
is not this at all.
And the first time you play Sanctum, you're going to be fighting through it, and you're going to be like, this is easy. They're not touching me. I'm crushing mm-hmm. it. And then you get to that final boss fight, and you're like, oh, I've been playing the whole game for this part in the, like.
Yeah, and that's the one thing that we've had players come in and go, wow, it's such a twist, because you're going from, but really, when you play through, the thing is it is a hack and slash. And that's the whole intent. The whole intent is, this is like Diablo. You grind through the monsters. You feel so incredible. You're untouchable. And then when you hit the boss, it's the test. How well did I actually build my character?
Yeah.
Did I build a good character, or was it just I was a really bad hero? And you're just like, and you see. And of course, yeah, there's some twists. There's a couple luck factors that might come in based on the cards. So it could be a little bit swingy, but that also makes it so that when you are burning through the game and min-maxing all four characters, you're not sitting there always knowing exactly what's going to come.
Yeah, and like all the characters are different. It took me, I picked the game up in BGG Con. At BGG Con, I picked it up, and I think it took me like three times to play through it before I actually didn't die on the last mm-hmm. boss.
You know, Rob scared us so bad. I only played it once, and we played with one other friend. And Rob scared us so bad about how mean the boss is going to be that we just destroyed the boss, both of us, the one time we played.
That's the first time I beat it, too. So
yeah. Yeah, yeah. I will say another thing I really like about Sanctum is that whole game, it felt like I was doing something the whole time, because I was like tinkering with my guy when it was other players' turns. And it's very easy to go like, well, I'm doing this, you can start your turn. It kind of had that Scythe feeling of the whole time I'm actually engaged in this game, even though what these guys are doing really doesn't have much of an effect on me the way other games might. It was still kind of like, there's some interaction, obviously, but mostly I was doing my own thing, but it felt like it was my turn a good chunk of the game instead of just like sitting there waiting for it to come around. And so that was really cool.
Yeah, I also really love Alchemist, but frankly, I'm awful at it. So when I'm playing with like people who actually play Alchemist, it's just ugly. Because I was playing with just my friends. We set it up, we got it going and everything, and first times I learned it and everything, and I'm like, this is a cool game. And then I get into a game with like Tyler, who's like, plays it right, and then I'm like, oh, okay, so I'm really bad at this game, like really bad.
That game definitely has like a next level to it, especially when you get into like a little bit of the bluffing and like.
Mm-hmm.
It's a game where, though, if you're playing it right, you should never be 100% sure of what you're doing. At least that's how I feel like.
Well, I think the thing is you have to figure out how to get points the whole time, at which point you need to make deductions based on what other people are doing as well. And then you have to be like, okay, I can reasonably believe this. And so you start making these assumptions. And so a lot of times you'll have like a bang up game where like you're riding lightning the whole time. And then like, if everybody's doing that, everybody's gonna have huge scores if they're all right. But you can also totally like make one small little error. And especially if you're playing with like the expansion or like the master variant rules, you can also crash and burn pretty easily in a game that will not forgive you for doing that. So,
and that's your fun. Favorite. That's your favorite, right, Cam?
Alchemist is like a crashing full step above all of the other ones, in my opinion. Now, I'm not saying like objectively, but what I like to play, yeah. And I think, you know, on the podcast, I always just go back to like the unique factor, like what's never going to be replaced. And to me, like Alchemist is maybe the most singular game. Just a stroke of brilliance. I'm sure there's other deduction, you know, Euros out there, but the mix of like the theme, the gameplay, everything that's integrated into it, and the expansion is so good too. The expansion is just phenomenal.
It just amps it up to 11.
Yeah. So yeah, I couldn't say enough nice things about Alchemist. Frankly, I couldn't say enough nice things about most Czech games, because they're all, just so brilliantly written and thematically implemented and just have a ton of character no matter which one we're talking about. And obviously that more and more with each like passing year, like the releases get more robust, I think. I wouldn't like go crazy saying that like Shipyard has like a undeniably brilliant theme. I'll say the mechanics are phenomenal and it's a super fun game. But definitely, like, within the last, like, 10 years or so, the stuff they've been putting out has just, like, been a bang-up on mechanics and theme, which is why I think Rob loves them so much, right?
Well, I started off as being, like, more of a Meritrash, just straight theme guy and not so much a Euro guy. And, like, their games had theme and they were Euro. So, like, that was kind of, like, my gateway into being a cube pusher a little bit. So that's why my favorite game might be nostalgia reasons, because I love all of them a lot, but like Dungeon Lords is probably my favorite. Maybe a little bit of a nostalgia pick there, but I really like the pre-planning and like shooting for the right spots on the board, and just the theme of being a dungeon lord and like a bureaucracy is funny. And then like the combat puzzle at the end, it's like there's two different kinds of parts of that game. And it might be like, I've got the collector's wooden box from the Kickstarter, and I met Vlaada I think it was the first or second year I demoed at Gen Con, and he signed the box for me. So
that's awesome.
Yeah, that's like probably my coolest board game thing I've got. Hold on.
The puppy is cute, apparently.
The puppy is cute, yeah.
My goodness.
So cute. Now what you do is you keep that in there, and then you go into Last Will, and you go into the story I had with Last Will with I accidentally brought a horse onto my boat trip one time because I didn't have the rules quite right, and I was like, oh yeah, I'll take my lady out on a boat trip with my horse, and I'm like, this is awesome. And I'm like, oh wait, yeah, and later I get in there and I'm like, you can't do that. And I'm like, oh well, that makes sense. It was the dog that I should have taken, not the horse. But
when in doubt, take all of your animals with you.
Tony, have you ever played the variant where you crush Last Will and Prodigal's Club together?
I actually haven't yet.
Oh man, you gotta. It's a trip. It is a full table full of game.
Yeah, I mean, when I was talking to Paul Grogan about it, he said that's the only way the designers play that game anymore.
That's the only way I play that game usually, when I can get nerds to play it with me.
Yeah. It's a lot.
I'll tell you though, if we talk a little bit about Lair Jam, I can tell you a story about how the designers play the game, and it's just, you just sit there and it's
all like, right. Let's hear it.
Let's dip into that. Let's talk about small box games.
Okay, so well, like my favorite small box game is Codenames. That said, it's also one that we end up playing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times.
Is there a particular like flavor that you like the best?
I like Duet.
Okay.
Duet's great.
Duet's amazing in my eyes. It's harder than normal Codenames. And you get in the groove of Codenames and you get into Duet with the cooperative with your partner. I do it with play with my wife all the time, and it's just, you're either right there in each other's heads and churning along well, or nothing is going right and this game is just destroying you.
Yeah, but it's so cool the way that one works too, where like you're not just on the guessing end, you're always on the giving clues end. And the way they have it set up so that you like have to guess a word that you know is a bomb word for you, and that you also share a bomb word in like with your partner, like the mind game of that, and then both people have that like hanging over them is so cool.
Yeah, that's always the linchpin part of that game, right? You're like, I need to point at this, but I know it might explode me.
Yeah, what ends up happening sometimes is when one player gets through all of them, and so like that player has guessed everything correctly, and then it's the other player and they're like, I know I have like three words that I have to somehow get out of this, and it's like brutal. It can be.
Yeah.
But yeah, let me jump into this little story so about Large Am. So when I was in Prague this Essen time frame, this last time, I sat down with Andra and some of the design team, and we played Letter Jam, and we played to get the top score. So everyone had seven letter words, and we played a full six-player game with everyone with seven letter words, and our native languages were four different languages.
Whoa.
So we're sitting there with people who are like American English, Slavic, Croatian, and Czech. And we're all sitting there. And at the very end, we got one person couldn't make their final word, had all the letters correct, but couldn't make their final word. And one person had one letter wrong. And this was the most like, because every single clue, except for two throughout the course of the game, must include every single person's word letter in that at that difficulty level. So every clue has to be six letters or more.
Wow.
Pretty much in the course of the whole game.
Were you using like English as a common language, or what?
Yeah, everyone was using English as a common language.
Okay.
But it was still like the person that couldn't get their word, I couldn't get my word because the word that he gave me was sea fish. And I'm like, that's not even a word, is it? And he's like, I don't know. It's a sea fish. And it's just like, and I'm like, this is like a 2 hour long game of Letter Jam. And we're like, just intense, like making all this. And it's like, it comes down to like sea fish. And I just shake my head and I'm just like, try to unscramble sea fish. And you just,
yeah, like, that's the kind of thing that, like, those are the gaming moments that, like, the next time you'll see that person, you guys can just say, like, sea fish and laugh about it. I mean, it's one of the things I love about gaming is just those moments you make, obviously, like that.
It was amazing. But definitely once you get into some of the design team games and playing with the designers, there's a different level for most of these games that is very much like an unforgiving, no rules are held back type of point scoring. And Alchemist is definitely one with the theories.
Well, if you look at like the scoring sheet for Letter Jam in the basic box, you know, if you're just playing with, and you're all just playing to play, and then you get, and you're like, well, how did we do it? We got like, oh, we got like 13 points. And it's like, wait, this goes up to like 300 or not like 300, but just I mean, you would really have to have a bang up game to score high up that track. So,
oh yeah, The track is definitely made to challenge gamers who want to check out, like, how good can I get?
And I'm trying to remember, so, and to do that, you basically have to run out of your letters and start getting bonus letters, right, to make, like, longer words?
Yeah, so you're getting bonus letters for longer words. You utilize the wild card for additional points. So basically, if you're playing a normal, like, four-letter, five-letter word game, you'd end up ending the game with everyone having, like, six-letter words.
Sure.
Because they've unscrambled their words and added a couple additional ones as well. It's kind of gaming it so that you don't end the game before people can get some additional points as well. So, because the scoring isn't dependent, you don't get any bonuses for ending sooner on the track. So you play out all the different rounds that you can to get the bonuses.
Gotcha. Now, I think I could guess Campbell's favorite small box CG game.
Oh, I have to think about what that is real quick. Hang on.
Let me just tell you what it is. Because I think that's going to be Pictomania.
No, I love Pictomania. I think it's great. But I think it's either Codenames Duet or Letter Jam, to be real. I do love drawing games, and I think Pictomania is one of the best. And the new implementation of Pictomania works much better, I think, than the old one.
Yeah, that was something that I thought they did that was really cool. They took, my guess is, I think Stronghold had it in the US maybe for you guys, and then you just basically redesigned it in a smaller box and a way lower price point, and you made the game better than the first time around. So, I mean, you just fixed some, like, weird, I forget what rules, but there were some weird rules that, like, you just streamlined and made better.
Yeah, well, basically the way the original one was set up, and test me on it right now, but I think what it was you could basically game the game so that you were, like, just looking at what everybody else was doing and then guess all that, then draw.
Oh, yeah, because you could pick your pencil up and put it down and then pick it up and put it down.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas now you have to, like, draw all your drawing, stop, and then you can't draw anymore.
Or something like that. Whatever it was, there was, like, weird ways to game it, and now there's not anymore.
Okay, well,
That's actually something I would say, without giving too much information, to keep an eye out on the future for Czech Games, is we have a lot, we don't get rid of our games. So, like, it's one of those things that, like, we work on our games and everything for long periods of time. And so different editions, newer updates, that sort of thing is something that you should, don't expect us to be like, oh wait, no, this is gone forever. It's more a,
everything's fair game. Everything's fair game. Yeah. That's cool. Yeah.
And we don't produce very many games a year. So
I was going to say, you come out usually with, like, one big game before Essen, and then it has been, like, one big game before Essen, and then one big, like, party game kind of before Gen Con. At least the last couple of years, that seems to have been the formula. I really like all those games we talked about, but just to talk about a different small box game, I really like Trap Words.
Trap Words is good.
I would say Trap Words or Pictomania. I like Codenames, obviously, and all those, but Trap Words is one that doesn't get a ton of love, and I love, like, looking across the table and trying to get in somebody's brain and figure out what kind of words they're going to use to try to describe the word. And then, you know, just to put that, like, dungeon crawl theme on it. I mean, who doesn't love that?
So. Can I change my mind to say Trap Words is my favorite? That game's brilliant.
Yeah. Well, next week I'm actually going to be talking a bit more about Trap Words too. We're working on so much right now just because our situation in the past month and a half has completely shifted where, like, we're so big on shows and we're not sure when the next show is going to be.
So yeah, I mean, you guys have pivoting. A pretty good presence at most cons, I'd say, right? At least all the big ones.
Yeah. And you talked about sponsorship at Gen Con. This year we're in the top, like, sponsorship levels type thing. So yeah. The thing is that it becomes a What are we going to do in this space if these conventions don't happen? And we've been looking at that a lot and talking about that. And I don't know if any of you saw the video I made on Codenames, but we're making a series of remote play, virtual type explanation tutorial videos so that people can know how to play our games with just like, just kind of like what we're doing now on like a broadcasting software with cameras and how to set it up though. Like it's not focused on how to play the game. It's focused on what is the ideal camera angle to play Codenames and what is the ideal
tech setup.
Yeah. And so we're trying to walk through some of these in the next few weeks. Just to give people the thought, you know what? Yeah, I can bring out Trappards, because Trappards was actually one that you only need one copy of the game.
I didn't think about that.
With one copy of the game, you can play with any number of people on a Zoom or Skype or whatever.
I've been trying to get like maybe Codenames together. I thought that would be pretty easy. Last night, I've been playing a lot online, a lot of Jackbox games and things like that. But last night we did just one. That party game, like that's a super easy game to play. Over Zoom.
Just one, on tour. Different role and rights are really easy typically. Yeah.
But you guys are doing like a Twitch stream for Codenames, right? I've been meaning to try to make one of those. If you ever need any players, you just let me know.
Yeah,
let us know, man.
No, absolutely. So Fridays, they start at 9 p.m. Eastern. They go till probably 1:30 in the morning, typically. So we'd make it a big Friday night thing. We probably play we played four last night. So we played four games of Codenames. Right around there is the sweet spot. We rotate out the teams halfway through. So we get one team of six people in. They play two games. That episode usually has that part of the episode has the special guests. This week was David Waybright from Man vs. Meeple. We had Ross from the OP. We've had Jess the Board Game Girl along with Mark Streed from the Dice Tower. Like we've been trying to bring in people to play that have their audiences and can kind of bring in people to play with them. And then after that, we switch over and we've actually been bringing people right in from the audience. So
nice.
Anyone with the webcam that's watching at the time, we just, if they're available, we bring them in. There's a little bit of risk there. We've been vetting people more. but it's just been one of those things where we're like, okay, let's have them join our Facebook group first and do it like a test your webcam. And then we'll jump in.
Let's make sure you have clothes on.
Yeah. So, but yeah, we watch that too. We have a delay on the broadcast. It is late night Twitch. So the adult
no holds barred.
Well, the adult language is not as enforced there, you know, but because of the gamer side of it, and we're nowhere near like the Modern Warfare guys playing, screaming at each other through their headphones. So
Ben, I think we missed you with the big game. Do you want to give us your big box, little box, Czech games? I know you probably haven't played a ton of the big box ones.
I mean, I would say that for the small box, Codenames is something that I got into even before I was playing, you know, any of like the more extreme games. And definitely have played that with a lot of people that you wouldn't be able to get playing many other games at all. So definitely had a lot of fun with that. Have a running joke with my mother-in-law that the way she plays Codenames drives me nuts because there's not supposed to be any table talk, but she will do everything in her power to give you more of a hint than one word.
Yeah, I have an aunt like that.
Okay, well, this is a stretch, but here's my one word. So,
I know those people.
But as far as the big box, I'm really taken by Zolkin. Obviously, we talked about that was one of the first games I played. One of the first games we had on the cast after I had joined officially. But I mean, there's a lot of games that have like a lot of pieces and, you know, a good table presence, that kind of thing. But to interact with the board that way, where it's turning and that's changing everything as you go. I mean, some games will change stuff with like, oh, flip over this bonus card on this round. Here's the modifier or something like that. That just, everything's changing. And so it's just, it's, that was a really cool thing to see. For me, I mean, the fact that it's Gears, like I work on equipment every day. So that's just appeals to me too. So that would probably be the one for me.
Yeah, going back to the uniqueness factor, I mean, there's no other game that's got moving stuff like that. I mean, it's a really cool brilliant. Deal. And we'll have to, Ben, we need to play that on BGA. BGA Board Game Arena has a really good Zulkin implementation.
Good. Let's do it.
We'll play it up.
So, Tony, let me ask you this. You were kind of commenting earlier on, with everything going on right now in the world and social distancing and quarantine, CG is pivoting away from spending resources on the big events and more into, you know, what can you do online? How can you bring people together like that? Taking something like board games that, you know, is a lot about people being same around the same table and kind of taking the investment you've made in the concepts and making that still accessible. So obviously we played the Through the Ages app, which was awesome. I've played the Galaxy Trucker app. Because I won a code at the Board Boys live event after season one. But you know, something like Code Names is, you know, a good party game that the number of people doesn't really matter so much. Can you talk about implementing that kind of game into Zoom and online stuff?
Yeah. So one of the things that we have been working on and has been in development for quite some time now, aside from the Dungeon Lords app, aside from the Dungeon Lords app, we've been working on a Codenames app. Now, that's still in development. It's going to be iOS and Android, but we've actually pivoted, like mentioned. And we're coming out with an online code names within the next, hopefully, month. Oh, nice. Now, this is going to be different, a different platform than the digital app. So if you go to codenamesgame.com, it brings up this thing and it says online, has a little sign up form for the email. And then it also talks about the app. So these are going to be two different things. There's going to be code names online, and there's going to be Codenames Digital. The digital is going to be the app. Online is going to be a broadcasted official program that allows you to use your camera to play Codenames.
Oh, nice.
So it's basically going to be, you open up the Codenames online, it's going to have Codenames, it's going to have the board and stuff like that. I'm not running through all the details by any means because it is being changed and made right now. But that project started literally 2 weeks ago. And we're like, within the next 4 to 6 weeks, we need to be launching this live.
Yeah.
So that's cool. That's one of the big projects that kind of just got like, all of a sudden we saw where we were in the world, what was happening. Mm-hmm. And we're like,
hold on.
We need to get this out there. Yeah. And so that's one of the really big ones that we're doing right now is the implementation of Codenames online. We're also doing like video series, like I mentioned before, and also just trying to figure out ways that we can connect through like the Twitch streams and through different live games. I'm going to probably be on as much third-party type podcast videos as I can get on right now, just because the thing is that we want everyone to have that degree of connection mm-hmm. that they're missing at the shows. Like, people aren't able to go and get their board game social fix by going out and playing at the shows anymore. So the thing is that if we can talk about it, have some fun, play some games online,
be accessible. And also just, I mean, that's awesome.
Yeah. And that's what we want. We want to be able to go, hey, by the way, maybe not next week, but we'll set up a time at some point and be like, you guys will all be on a Twitch stream playing Codenames with us. And then basically the people who listen to this can come over and be like, play the game and or watch us play. Like that's what I want to do, is try to figure out ways that we can actually start connecting with the audience more, because frankly, everybody is stuck.
Yeah. And
I mean, you can tell by the volume of all the online, like, BGA is always like all the online gaming things are just swamped. So I mean, there's obviously a need, like people are thirsty for this stuff. While we're talking about the app, so I think Alchemist might have been your first. Well, I'll get to that in a second. But, Alchemist, I think, was probably you guys' first app and really one of the first board game apps, period. As far as like, and I know there's a big hullabaloo of no apps in my board game. I don't care about that. I think it's great.
It's 2020.
Well, and Alchemist as an app is very differently implemented than a lot of like other automated apps. Like it's kind of, it kind of just helps you play the analog board game.
Sure. So, I mean, you guys have what, Alchemists? You've got okay. So for companion things, I guess you have Alchemists. The Letter Jam companion thing just came out. I think that might be it for
I have Codenames companion app too, the Codenames gadget.
Okay, there's a Codenames companion app. And then you've got Through the Ages is the actual game. Galaxy Truckers the game. Codenames Digital is going to be the game. And then you've got the online Codenames you just talked about. I noticed, like, how you guys do your own development in-house. Do you guys have your own app devs?
Yeah, we actually have a digital team in-house that creates and develops all of our games digitally. They also work very side by side with our board game designers.
I mean, so, Mattis Kochery is like one of them, right? He did Alchemist, and he's one of the developers.
I believe so, and also Andre Scoopy, the designer of Letter Jam, is one of the digital team developers as well. So the thing is that we have a lot of our design team developing these apps, and I know Vladia is working very closely on the Codenames project. So everything,
he was originally a developer too, I think, right? Or maybe he still does coding. I don't know.
Still does some degree, I believe. I'm not really sure on that side. But he's very invested in how the game comes out. So one of the big things, I mean, we're gamers. That's the core of like our company, is gamers that made games that they wanted people to enjoy and play. And we've been successful in that. But at the same time, coming into this, it's like, okay, so do we focus on being a business now? And the answer for us is no. The answer is we want to make sure that the game, when it comes out, is actually true to how we see the game and think it should be. Because, I mean, what you see with a lot of board game companies, and I've worked for a number of them through the years, is basically at some point in time, decisions are made at times that may sacrifice some of the game for manufacturing costs, for whatever purposes. And what I found here is that is not the way it works with Czech Games Edition.
Maybe that's one of the things that draws me to you guys, because it's quality over quantity, right? And I think the board game industry in a whole, at least my belief is, like, the current number of games being cranked out every year is not like a sustainable thing. So I think I'm hoping more companies realize that and try to put out like less higher quality games, less games and make them higher quality. Well, let me say that correctly. But and I know you guys aren't afraid to push a game back. Like the Through the Ages expansion got kind of pushed back a little bit for various reasons, I noticed. And
yeah,
you know, a lot of times you guys are in like, cause I'll follow your online stuff, and you guys sometimes will just finish a print run and put it on a truck and then drive it up to Essen. Like,
yeah, no, I mean,
sell it the next day.
A lot of people don't understand, but that whole side secret of the industry is a lot of companies do that, but they do it for Gen Con.
Sure.
So a lot of companies are like, let's print this airship a palette and get it at Gen Con so we can show it off at the show. Sure. Essen is kind of like the 3-hour drive from our warehouse and manufacturing facility. So it's like, print it, get it on the truck and drive it to Essen and get it in there. And whereas a lot of companies, like US based companies, couldn't do that for Essen, but we do. and that's kind of what happened with the Through the Ages expansion. The biggest thing was is that there was actually an error, where the cards, so many print runs of Through the Ages have happened through the years. So like if there are 15 different print runs and somewhere along the line, maybe 8 or 7, the card stock changed. Now nobody would ever notice that because you're not mixing a print run number 2 with a print run number 8. But when you have an expansion and people have all the different versions that have come out through the years, it didn't match with some of the versions. So what we ended up, because of like paper type or something like that. So what we ended up doing was actually including all of the cards that would be affected in that box. So like you get a whole new military deck. So you'll just swap it out from your game. So you have the whole deck with the new cards so that all the cards match. Because it was completely unacceptable for us to have cards in that deck that you could tell what they were.
Yeah.
Because Through the Ages, once you get into the especially with the high level competitive nature of it, that happens. If you have any indication of what cards are happening beforehand, with like more knowledge than you're supposed to have, you have an unfair advantage.
Yeah, and that's a game where that definitely could come out for sure.
You get a lot of card counting type in that game just naturally. Mm-hmm. Going, okay, these cards haven't come in yet, so I'm expecting this leader is going to be coming soon, or these cards are going to be coming soon, and you can start gauging your play based on what is still available. The best players do. I do not.
I was gonna say,
you could tell me what's coming in, like, and remind me multiple times over the course of a game. Be like, here's everything, and I'd still lose by 100 points.
So let's.
I can't even read the cards right.
That's true. In our live play, Ben put a card in the thing that completely like was terrible for him, just because he didn't read it right. And I had one of the abilities that let me like peek at what people were playing. I think it was Nostradamus, and I was like, Ben, why did you put that in there?
I was like, yeah, I didn't. I just realized I didn't read that right.
So let's talk about my 800-pound gorilla in the room, and it's probably just me. When I backed the Dungeon Lords Deluxe Box Huge Anniversary Edition, one of the stretch goals was a Dungeon Lords app. It was supposed to just be like the combat, like a combat puzzle game. And you guys had just kind of started up, I think, the app in-house kind of thing, and had just done maybe Alchemist or something. And it was coming down the pipe, and then a couple Gen Cons happened. I didn't hear anything. I asked them, like, oh, we're doing a Codenames app. It kind of got pushed back. And then
he's here to collect.
You mentioned it. I mean, I put it in the show notes, but
give him the prototype, Tony.
But I've been waiting for this thing because I just think that would be a really cool app idea. What can you tell us about that?
So,
and I guarantee you, I'm probably like only one of a handful of people that probably even remember this.
We get messages from time to time. That's okay. It's definitely one of those things. It's on the project list.
Okay.
It's definitely in works.
It didn't fall off the list.
I'm almost certain it's not fallen completely off the list. It's
not
just
completely.
Been,
there you go, Rob.
It's been delayed by other projects and different.
It's going to be an Era 3 app, Rob, if that tells you anything.
I mean, I could give like the marketing spiel because I'm U.S. marketing. I could be like, you know, it's something that we're always thinking about and working on, and it's.
You're clearly very excited about it.
I'm sure when it releases, it will be fabulous.
It will be amazing.
Hey, I was going to say, if the same people are making the Codenames app that made Through the Ages app, I'm on board, 100%.
Yeah, the quality level of the apps that we're putting out are going to be right in line, same or better than what we have in the past.
And Rob, think of the quality of this one for how long it's been delayed. I mean,
From what I've seen on the Codenames app,
cooking it low and slow.
And I can't talk about any of the Codenames app stuff, but from what I've seen, it's going to blow people away.
That's awesome.
Well, I mean, if it's anything like your other ones,
it's implementing above and beyond. And I think that's the whole thing. It's
well, I think that kind of tees back into what you were saying earlier about like, you guys don't take shelves and or take games and just put them up on the shelf and you're done with it now. Like, you're always willing to implement on that. Yeah. And so when you talk about going and making a digital version of something, especially kind of pushed into it, you know, with how stuff is now, it's not just like, okay, let's scan all the cards and smush it onto an app. Like,
definitely
you're
not
taking that opportunity to let's fine tune this as much as we can. Like, how do you translate something that is fun in a group around a table and take technology and leverage that as best you can?
Well, I mean, there's a lot in that too. It becomes a discussion too of, do we want to implement it like we implemented? And honestly, I'll tell you straight up, I am not the digital marketing person. I am the U.S. board game person. So if I say something, I'm sorry, Reggie. But
put him in a corner.
But one of the things we do is we determine whether or not this is going to be an app like Galaxy Trekker or Through the Ages. And what I mean by that is, Through the Ages is a true implementation of the game. Galaxy Trekker is as well. But it brings in adventures in this campaign and a whole storyline of actions and things that are happening that are outside of what you get when you buy Galaxy Trekker, the box. So that's one of the things that come into this. And honestly, like, just, this is me kind of spitballing, but the thing is this, the Dungeon Lords thing might come with a new version at some point. Like, that might be what the higher ups at this point are kind of looking at, is the fact that, you know, at this point in time, the best thing for this would be to wait for like you said, like the re-release Pictomania style. I don't know. Honestly, that one is outside of my immediate knowledge of where we're going on it, but it's definitely something that I know that we've promised something to the fan base. We're going to figure out something for it. It's not a matter of we're just going to drop it.
It's just cool that that is sort of the philosophy at CGE, you know, that's different, like you said, than some other places.
And one of the things that it hasn't come up this time, but there was a lot of talk about Tash Kalar in the past as well, about different implementations and things like that with it. And Tash Kalar is also one that is always on our hit list. Like, it may not be getting the news and everything that we see right now, being kind of the not two player but two player ish game by Vlaada that is a little bit more abstract combat. And we're always bringing up what about Tash Kalar, what can we do with that, and going from there.
All right, well, I think we're gonna wrap this up here in a little bit, but I just have a couple more questions. One, do you have any, like, a couple questions I've always had is, why do you guys have such like humor and theme in your rule books? Do you know the answer to that? Like, because that's something that I've always like enjoyed, like the Dungeon Lords rule book especially has almost like a conversational tone to it. Is that just like the CGE personalities behind like people that write the rule books, or?
There's a little bit of that. Some of it also is from what I've gathered. And honestly, this is coming in, like, I only have been working for the company since like Essen last year. But part of the Czech culture is humor. Sometimes it's a little bit more dry and sarcastic than the people in the United States can handle. But it's there, and very much in a little bit cutting edge way sometimes. And so it's definitely something that you see come into the rule books and apps. And also we try to make the little Easter eggs like that as much as we can.
Yeah, I definitely dig it. And the, you know, there's always the Easter eggs kind of in the artwork sometimes too.
Yeah.
How about you just give us a rundown of what's coming out or what's new from CGE as far as, I mean, you've run over some things, but I know there's more, so.
Yeah, so the latest and greatest, we have been focusing a lot on the online and everything like that. One of the big things we did with that was a Through the Ages sale. We did a huge charity promotion where we sold Through the Ages and Galaxy Trekker apps at half off. We set the time. The times ended differently for the different platforms because they have different links that you can set sales for. So we put the maximum length of time for each of the platforms and we ran the sale. Through our fans' generosity, we raised $106,000.
Wow.
That we are donating to COVID relief. We're working right now through the red tape of how to donate that much money. And who and where this is going. But that much money is being donated. That was raised during this period through that sale. And then we just announced Under Falling Skies. So that is going to be, that would be the Gen Con release time period this year. So we are still gearing towards that being released in that fashion. And this is actually our first venture into a solo game.
I hadn't looked too much at it. Is it purely solo?
No. So that's one of the fun things about this game that we found in testing is that it is collaborative. So if you were playing it with like two or three people, you would all be collaborating on your turn on what you do. Because this is a very like puzzly, high difficulty game. So kind of what we've been saying is that you might need more than one person just to get through it. The game itself was a 9-card print and play contest game on BGG, and we have since reworked some things with the designer, and the designer's actually on our team, on our development team now, and he is working on the game. We just put out it's on our Facebook page, but if you go there, there is a new version of the print and play. This is not the game that's going to be published, but it's an updated, modified print and play version of the game. Okay. The published version is going to have a lot of cool stuff with it. It's going to have different mission type things and some scenario play as well, I believe. And yeah, it's definitely...
So it's kind of a card puzzle game?
So it is... So the premise of the game is you are defending the cities in the world. And you have an underground bunker, and the motherships are coming in and dropping ships down upon you. And what you have to do is you have to destroy the mothership by getting your research up to the point before the mothership descends and actually, or before the dropships actually destroy it. So the way this works is you're rolling dice and you're placing those dice in the different slots in your bunker that perform the different actions. There are a number of ways to mitigate the dice. There are actually two different colors of dice, and when you use one of them, you have to reroll all the rest of the dice at that point in time. So there's a number of different things going in there, but it's all utilizing the different actions based on the dice at your disposal to move the different ships, or wait, to move the different things within your bunker. But the big thing is this. So if I use a six, I'm going to gain a bunch of like energy, for example, but it's going to move a ship down six. So all the courses of action that you do with your dice placement are actually going to directly correspond not only with like your resource generation, but also the amount of like difficulty of the different dropships that come down. So it's a really thinky, strategic game. I don't really know how to like classify it, because you're it's dice placement with the resource generation and everything, but it's really unlike anything that I've played. It has very puzzle, very high strategy, and
yeah. Well, I can imagine a solo game would be very puzzly from you guys. If anyone has ever done a Board Game Geek contest from CGE, those things have nutso questions in them that really make you work for the answers. So,
sounds tight, though.
Yeah, and like especially a solo game right around now sounds great to me. Assuming Gen Con, yes or no, do you think it'll be released in the wild around that time frame anyway? Or
we're working on having it released in the time frame this year, regardless of what happens.
Is it a small box, big box game? Like, what kind of price point do you think?
So it's coming in right around the $30 price point. We're going to have it in a box that is, which one is it? It is the same size as this one, the Through the Ages expansion. So okay. It's not our small box party game size, but it's not a bigger box size. It's that one that's kind of in the middle. It's also, sure. I think Last Will is that size as well. Somewhere in that range.
Somewhere, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, that's, I'm always interested to see, you know, when solo games come out, because that's actually a really big niche market now, I believe. And especially so many games at least come out with a solo variant to them. I think that really probably helps sales. If you can put one, instead of two to four, if you can put one to four on a box.
It does. But that's one of the things too that we're kind of looking at. We don't think you should do that.
Like you shouldn't just shoehorn in like something that you think is gonna give you a sales bonus,
a sale, that's kind of against our philosophy. Is we don't want to put a solo variant on the game unless it's like really intended to be played that way, and that's kind of the thing, is that a lot of games come out and it's like, yeah, we could have taken Sanctum and given you a modified deck of cards or half sheet piece of paper that said, yeah, look, you're just gonna flip these things and then you can play solo.
Like you're playing all four positions. There's no way around it.
But the game's not intended there are things in the game that are there for the purpose of, yeah, there isn't a lot of interaction, but the interaction there is well thought out. And we have the different achievements and stuff like that in there for a reason. And it's just one of those things where it's like, yeah, let's slap a solo mode. We don't want to do that. So that's kind of where this is actually our first solo game, because it's intended to play as a one player or collaborate with two or three.
I guess that philosophy makes sense to me, because I've noticed a few of your Euro games really seem to be geared towards like an actual four player count. Because like Dungeon Lords, Dungeon Pets, Zulkin's probably like the easiest one to like, because the dummy players just sit in a wheel. But like if you play Dungeon Lords at anything besides four, you're kind of fiddling with the second and third players, and it truly is like a four player game. But you do allow us to play two or three.
And that's one of those are, that's a little bit harder, because there are a lot of people in the 2 to 4 range.
That, oh, 100%.
Right, basically. And it's becoming one of those things where here in the next 5-10 years, maybe board gaming is going to evolve and that's going to be a 1 to 5. Like, yeah. Basically, where, or a 1 to 4, and then the 5th and 6th player expansion type model. I don't know, but I'm excited that this is the first venture into solo gaming that we have, because this one's, we're trying new things. And I like the new things, so we're going to see what happens. So,
and then the Through the Ages expansion is out on the app, and is it in stores yet? Is it close?
It is very close. I have a copy behind me. It's actually it's on the water, with the new cards on the water. It's releasing, I believe, May 14th.
Okay.
Let me double check that real quick. We're shooting for like May 13th, that Wednesday, the second week of May. But it might be the weirdest thing right now with our industry is distribution and retail stores being closed.
Yeah, our local one, our biggest local one has started to offer curbside pickup.
Mm-hmm. But the background thing that people aren't noticing is this. So, and just supply chain 101 for board game industry, when you dive into it, a retail store buys product from the distributors. The distributors have to have stock. So we're fighting the distributors to buy stock. And like, their distributor partner, we're not fighting, but we're like, hey, you have to get stock so the retailers can get it. But the retailers also are in a little bit of a cash crunch because they just took 2-3 weeks of being closed. So they're buying things either that they know people want, pre-ordered, stuff like that. And so they're being a little bit more careful. The distributors are being a little bit more careful. So it slows down the whole supply chain. Yeah. So,
well, the last thing I read was the distributors weren't even distributing.
Like, that happened for a period of time within this too, but at the same time, that changes day to day. So we have some distributors that are closed still. There are other distributors that are open completely for business. Others that some of their warehouses are closed, some of them are open. So it's kind of one of those things that right now, the best thing that I can recommend is go to your call in. Don't go to the store. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying
stand outside with a sign.
Yeah, call into your store and put in the product on backward, or like tell them I
want pre-order
these games. Please pre-order these games for me. The biggest thing that you can then do is point your store to us. So we're not selling direct. But what we're going to do is, for one, we're going to see if they're signed up for our support relief package. We have a retail-centric support promotion that we're doing for them. We're not putting it public or anything, but we do have a promotion in place that they can sign up for and get relief, help and support from us. And then we can also facilitate calling the distributors and saying, hey, I have these orders for these retailers. Can you get that product going out to them? And so it can prompt distributors ordering product that they might not have on order. It can prompt getting that system going a little bit faster. Like I said, though, it's right now it is a slower process, and that's one of the things we say, that if you can support your retail store, your local retail stores, we think that's the best option. But we also understand if that's not what you want to do, that most of our games are available on different online vendors like Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Walmart, Target.coms. So if that's the method that you want to purchase, absolutely. We're just trying to support all of our partners the best we can.
Sure. And then your other more recent release was Sanctum, and that seems to be going pretty well, pretty popular out there.
Yeah. We're happy with Sanctum. Basically, the biggest thing with Sanctum that we are going to be doing is we're going to be continuing promotion of it and Large Am through the next. You know how we do it.
We're going to keep talking about it. I just think like Sanctum is like ripe for like expansion stuff. Because you put out like the Adrenaline DLC for that game, and I could just see, you know, more monsters. Or I thought it'd be cool if you could get like, you could collect like item sets or something that like gave bonuses to each other. I play tested it a little bit and kind of gave a little bit of feedback towards it, because you kind of bring, sometimes you bring your games to Gen Con that are going to come out at Essen, and then
the only thing that I can say about expansion content with our company is just note that like where you just put out the Through the Ages expansion, we also tend to typically have a year span or so between core game and expansion launches, just because we want to make sure that if we make an expansion, it's something that actually increases and benefits the game. But it's the same thing that I've been talking about.
Sure. And then I really just have one more question for you, and you probably can't answer it, but I've been itching for another Vlaada Big Box game. I know he's been cranking out those party games, but I feel like he's got to be cooking something back there, right?
The heaviest game. Right.
I can't talk box
about this. I've never seen.
No, he has been working on new designs.
Cool. That's an answer.
I mean,
cool. can you send us detailed PDFs? Probably can't, right? Wink.
I can't really like that's one of the funny things. You're sitting there and you're like, so one of the owners of your company, can you tell me like what he's working on right now? It's like yeah, well, I know he's working on things, but I
probably
honestly,
not. Here's the funny thing is, he holds a lot of power.
Yeah.
Whatever he wants to.
Yeah. You're right. I want that too.
Yeah. And that's one of the things. Like, there have been, I mean, we usually have a few events where we play different games, and we've seen some different things that he's been working on, and some of them, like, we're just sitting there going, just launch it. And he's like, let's just wait.
Oh, yeah, I've seen.
No, I have to see. Like, I don't know about this.
And I definitely then had a conversation on Instagram when they posted a picture of, it was some game that was in the works. I'm not sure if it's one that actually came out yet or not. But I was prodding the person to know if that was the new Vlaada game or not. All right, well, Tony, thank you so much for being on the Quarantine Board Boys podcast.
This was great. This is fun.
Is there anything else you want to say before we go?
No, just stay safe. And if you have any questions, definitely reach out to us. We're here behind the social media and everything else. So it's not like you can't get a hold of us if you need to.
Yeah. We want to thank you again for, hooking some of the guys who didn't already have the expansion up with the expansion there for so we can play that game live. And also, Tony, if you feel like playing Codenames with some of the board boys here, holler at us.
Oh, absolutely.
We do that 100% of the time. Or if you just want to play some Zulkin with us, too. I know Ben, board boy Ben, would be definitely into that.
Yeah, no, actually, honestly, I'm up for playing games as much as I can, so.
Yeah, like to hear that. What's your maybe I'll have to ask you after we're done recording what your
VGA handle. Yeah, by the way, you can go ahead and message all your personal
I've given my phone number live on the air before, on the podcast before, and the only other person who took advantage of having my phone number was Chris Yee from the Meeple Overboard podcast, but I got plenty of text messages from him.
Oh, man. Yeah, no, but afterwards we can definitely swap information and I can throw up like Tony at Czech Games. That's like the official way to get a hold of me if anything's needed. Any questions, stuff like that. I can definitely refer you to the right people for whatever the question is. So,
all right. Well, until next time, we hope you like board games.
Thanks a bunch, Tony.
I appreciate it.